Close enough.
Close. Okay. Close enough. Our first speaker will be John Montgomery, your friend on Python. John, are you ready? Mm-hmm. Okay, stage is yours.
Go, John.
Hey everybody, I'm John Montgomery. I'm here to talk to you about Your Brain on Python. It's basically a short neuroscience programming language combo here. More meant to inspire people than to talk about work I've done, just because I'm more on the computer science side and just an amateur on the neuroscience side. I really love the ideas, but I don't have a research lab to back me up, so it kind of causes problems.
Nice one.
So a disclaimer. Any time where I'm linking in Python here, it's pretty much hypothetical. There's not too much research in the overlap between programming languages and neuroscience. I want to know more about this, but I've only got so much time, so hopefully some of you will be inspired by this and will do that work for me, and then I can read about these awesome things. So first off, your brain and Python are a symbiote. They work together. You know, Python takes your time and your effort and gives you superpowers back, or at least coding skills. I don't know about the rest of you. Did you guys get superpowers? So different parts of the brain that are, these are the four main parts and how I think they might be used in Python. So you've got your frontal lobe. It might be used for the logical flow of programming, for some critical thinking, for designing algorithms. It's the very logical, rational part of your brain. You've got your parietal lobe, which is movement, orientation, recognition. So obviously movement, the actual physical act of typing Python. Recognition, maybe finding errors. So whenever you see range of len of x, you know, okay, this needs to be put into an iterator or something instead. So temporal lobe, so memory, you know, keeping nearby variables in your head, knowing what the value should be and shouldn't be. Also, perception recognition of auditory stimuli. I think this is actually important. You know, you need to be able to hear when your boss or your spouse is sneaking up on you so you can get back to doing real work or cleaning or whatever it is you're supposed to be doing instead of Python programming. Then there's also visual processing, which, you know, might be doing with reading Python or understanding it more, recognizing errors as well. So we've got some more specific pieces as well. This is the caudate nucleus. So if you've ever been talking to your, you know, Eastern European grandmother and she starts switching into Romanian halfway through a conversation, it's this guy that does that for her. So maybe this is important, switching between reading Python and reading comments and how well you can transition that. Visual beauty in terms of making elegant code, which is very important. We've also got these two areas, one doing with speech production and understanding speech. Whether or not those have anything to do with Python, not as sure, but there's also this section that's not marked there called the angular gyrus, which is used in reading and writing, which I'm almost certain is used in Python at some point. So we know that Python's a language, which is obvious. It's a programming language. It has grammar, syntax, spelling rules, etc. It's math, you know, it's equivalent to algorithms. It's got the Church Turing thesis, etc. It's also an art. You know, you have beautiful, elegant code. It makes it better. It also has some aspect of motion to it. There's program flow. Data passes in and out of functions. It's changed as it goes. But what does our brain think it is? This is the real important part. So now you guys are wondering, why is this important? So it's important for effective teaching. But if you're checking out expert Python programmers' brains, it only works if the beginners are sane. So maybe beginners think of Python as a language initially, and then it changes into they start thinking of it more mathematically, and then eventually they start thinking about it more artistically. We need to know if those transitions happen. So effective language design. This has probably got a overlap with a lot of neurolinguistics. We want to design the language so that the most amount of people can use it effectively. Also, just more ways to think about programming. So yesterday's talk, Sandy Strong and Christine Chung, they mentioned how they tell some of their students to think of it as math, and that helps them out. So just do what works for you. And so in conclusion, get in people's head, and if anybody has a functional MRI lying around they want to lend to me or just straight up give me, please contact me. My information's right there, and thank you for your time.
Montgomery, your brain on Python. We're in California. Medical Python is legal. Did I understand correctly? Thank you so much. Our next speaker, René Naisan, Us Thinking the Dot. Are you ready?
Yes.
You ready? Cool. So, give him a big hand. René Naisan, Thank you.
Start. Good morning. I'm here to talk about the PyWorks, which is yet another framework somebody made. This time it's me. It's a concurrency framework. I think there's been a lot of talk about concurrency, or it's just me looking for it. Could be. And PyWorks is kind of my input to that whole discussion on how we're going to do concurrency. As David said, what we can do when owning the dot. I went to his excellent tutorial here on Thursday, I think, expecting, you know, really devilish things from Mesa programming, but he did not start a single thread in a Mesa class, so I was kind of disappointed on that. My background for talking about this is that I have always, in my whole professional career, been doing concurrency, real-time systems. It all comes back to a woman, of course. Bodil Schröder, which in 1996 wrote a thesis on called MIC, a coroutine OS for microcomputers. And it's kind of been building on that from that time. It's already been interest. If any of you are interested, you should definitely have a look at ABCL, the actor-based concurrent language, if you want to, you know, really have your head explode. Every object is asynchronous, and even the meta classes are asynchronous. Everything is measured, just going around. Excellent language if you have time to look at it. And also, I've been looking at Erlang lately, has some interesting features. When I began programming concurrent languages, I was doing it in C, we were doing it on a microprocessor. We wrote code like that, you know, the forever, and if you were a bit fancy, you wrote for instead of while true. And then you just sit there receiving messages and handling whatever came in, maybe sending him on to a new task. So when I started hearing about object-oriented, I immediately thought, well, that's great. That's a class. It's an object. It will run asynchronously, and it's much cleaner. You know, you don't have to receive and all that stuff. So for a while, I actually thought that, you know, that's how it works. Turned out that that wasn't the case. There was something called threads. We, you know, ran across my code, and I got huge stack traces, and we didn't understand anything about what was going on. So in 2005, we made something called CoWorks, which ran in Java and in C#. Every task is an instance of a process. Object references are proxies, and return values are futures, and that actually runs in a lot of places in our production systems, like that. I read somewhere that being a programmer, you program for work. Program is your hobby, and when you don't program, you think about it, and that's kind of what I do with concurrency. So I started thinking, well, you know, how can you do that, and how can you do this in Python? And this is a simple example of a concurrent PyWorks program. And the thing is that it runs in Python, in CPython. Just it's sequential. If you run it in PyWorks, it's faster because we're in parallel. And if you run it on on a CPU with more cores, if you haven't had the gill, it would run even faster. But it's the same piece of code. So that's kind of where I am right now. And I, you know that it's probably not going to go into production anywhere. But I think it's a different way to think about concurrency. And at the off chance that Guido might be here today, I couldn't resist to, you know, come up with a proposal. Say, have a look at the bang operator in Erlang. So instead of, you know, the good old-fashioned synchronized method call, we could add just that to Python and have asynchronous messages flown around in the system. And that's it. You can have a look at Pyworks. Thank you.
Good job.
Randy and I are syncing the dot. Thank you so much. And we were synchronous with the time. That's great.
Absolutely perfect. A lot of people ask questions about the Python Software Foundation, and sometimes I tell them, it's a great organization, but getting things done in the Python Software Foundation can sometimes seem a bit like mating elephants. Everything's done at a very high level. It involves a certain amount of roaring and screaming and possibly some pain. And when it's all over, it still takes 3 years to see any results. Okay, so moving on, the next speaker is Manzoor Mohammed, and he's going to talk to us about TUF, a secure update framework.
Thank you very much. My name is Manzoor Mohammed, and I'm a student at NYU Poly, and I will be introducing you guys to a project called the Update Framework, also known as TUF. So TUF is a project that my advisor, Justin Kappas, has worked with several students over the years, and here I'm here to introduce the project, and one of my fellow students, Trishank, has done a video capture of introducing TUF along with a demo of showing what it can do. So I'm going to play this video and hope you guys enjoy the talk about TUF. Any people in PyPy would be very much interested into this.
Hi, I'm Trishank, and I'm going to talk to you about TUF, specifically the problem of how do we secure PyPy? Now, what do I mean by that? PyPy is valuable, it's awesome, isn't it? It makes life so simple and convenient. But consider security researchers, though, is this. What if someone hacks PyPy, or easier, it's package developers? Now, as you know, software repositories are valuable targets. Debian, Fedora, kernel.org, Microsoft, SourceForge, all were compromised at one point or another. So currently, PyPy has got some good security practices in place. So for one thing, it protects all your connections to PyPy with SSL. This is great. And it also, when you download a package, say Beautiful Soup, it checks its MD5 sum, or you could use a stronger hash. So you make sure you get the package that you wanted. But here's the problem, though. If an attacker could go in and replace packages, then he could very well replace the hashes of those packages. So SSL and hashes alone are not enough security here. And we studied attacks like this on package managers a few years ago, and I don't have time to go into all the details right now, but as we check out our paper and technical report, I'm happy to say that package managers such as apt, yum, portage, yast have adopted some of our security suggestions. And so our solution to the general problem of secure software update framework is called TUF, which stands for the update framework. Again, I regret to say I don't have the time to go into all the details here, but definitely check out our paper. I'll give you a metaphor in the meantime. Now, if you know something as important as launching a missile strike, you certainly don't want one person to be responsible for it. You want at least two people, or three, depending on your security constraints. And you want them to make the decisions together and turning the key together. So we apply ideas like that to software updates, for example. And you also have ideas like referential integrity of a release. So you're very sure that this set of packages they belong together at this point in time. They're consistent, they're meant to be downloaded with each other, right? And so enough words, let's show you a demo. We have a demo of PyPy and Pip working with TUF today. What do I mean by that? So here's an example of Pip using TUF to download Django. And there you go, it's done it. Now, what we're doing is, we didn't even have to modify PyPy a lot. In fact, we didn't modify it except for adding TUF metadata. And we very subtly modified Pip to say, we added a decorator to say, hey, you know, when you're talking to like pypy.python.org, actually use TUF instead. And we do all this magic behind the scenes, like talk to TUF, get the metadata, get the file, check the hashes, check its size and everything. And everything is all in well and good in this case, nothing went wrong. So, and Pip already does this though, right? It's got SSL, it's got hash checks. What's new here? We'll consider the subtle problem of an attacker going in and owning PyPy, right? Hacking PyPy and saying, look, I'm going to do a very subtle form of attack. It's a freeze attack. I'm just not going to publish any updates at all, including security updates. So you make people insecure by not even doing anything, just not doing anything new, right? It's a very subtle form of attack. So what happens with Pip in this case? Oh, look, Pip with TUF says, something went wrong. Pip throws this error. It's from TUF, and it says, expired metadata error. What we did was we fast-forwarded to the future from when we know that the metadata would expire, and as expected, staff raises an error and says something's wrong. The metadata should have, it's expired now and there's nothing new in the server. You definitely got to talk to somebody. So pip is protected from this attack with TUF today. And you can check out the source code. It's all on GitHub. And these are the people who worked on TUF. You may see Justin Samuel and Jeremy Condra at PyCon this year. So if you see them, definitely say hi and talk to TUF with them. And if you have questions, send us an email at info@updateframework.com or go to our website at updateframework.com. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Oh.
Yeah, that's it.
Yeah, okay.
Thanks, guys.
Yeah.
Thank you, Manzo.
We have some lost and found, or we have the next talk?
Let's have the next talk, and then we'll announce the lost and found.
Okay.
Away you go.
Our next talk in the quest for Python world domination. PyCon will extend to Poland. Filip Klepczyk of PyCon Poland. Are you ready?
Yeah, of course.
Okay.
I am Filip Klepczyk. That's my email, that's my Twitter handle, and I will talk about PyCon PL. By the way, it's my first lightning talk in English, but I think that it will be awesome. Okay, I'm coming from Poland. Poland is a country in Central Europe, so it's not so far away from United States, believe me. Some common myths say that we have bears on streets, but actually this photo was taken in United States. Why Poland is a cool place this year? So, first of all, there's a PyCon PL 6th edition, and of course, DjangoCon Europe Circus edition. I will talk about PyCon PL because I'm the main organizer. So, it will be in October, it will last for 4 days, it will be organized in a hotel that is situated in mountains. What kind of activities will be there? So talks, trainings, tutorial, lightning talks. And as far as languages are concerned, we are also looking for English speakers. Last year we had about 50% of talks in English, so we are looking forward to make this number even bigger this year. Website isn't ready for this year's edition, but you can follow us on Twitter and there will be an announcement when the call for papers will run. If you ever visit Poland, there are a lot of local meetups and as far as I observe, new ones are coming. How is PyCon PL like? So, very short trip from the first edition to the current one. I will show you some photos, so you will have an idea how it looks. So, it was the first edition. We had above 100 attendees on the first edition. Then we decided that we changed the formula and moved to a single hotel. So all attendees are in a single hotel that it's usually in the middle of nowhere. So after the talks, everyone stays in hotel and the socializing and networking continues through the whole night till morning. So it's a good thing. We always choose a venue that is close to nature if someone feels to go and rest. We had a very interesting speakers during all the years. You probably will recall some of the faces. We also have musicians programming Python. Probably you know Brandon from yesterday's talks. We do open air lightning talks. Kind of interesting thing during barbecue. Another well-known person, another Python gurus. The number of people keeps increasing every year, so we will probably exceed 200 this year. So. On the previous edition, we had a cake because we already finished 5 years. So we are kind of a major PyCon conference. Okay, I wanted to use the remaining time to tell about the project that is done by my friend that couldn't reach this conference because he was actually handing over his master's thesis. So it's very interesting. Service, gpodder.net. It's a web service to manage your podcast subscriptions. And it's based on Django and CouchDB NoSQL database is used. It's whole open source, so you can join the project, contribute. There are also a lot of desktop and mobile clients that work with this service. Some of them run on Python using PyGTK or PySide. This is how it generally looks, so you can check it yourself by going to gpodder.net. You can visit site, you can see the source code, and you can follow on Twitter developers. So my talk is probably over.
Woo! Philip Klepczyk about PyCon Poland. Thank you very much.
Well done, Philip, and good luck with the conference in October. Well, it's great to see a good turnout this morning. I see that the hangovers are slowly staggering in at the back there. Hello. So, a bit of lost and found. A driver's license in the name of Jeffrey Bartonek. Two flash drives. A rental car key for a Nissan Versa. This is no joke. Rental car keys cost upwards of $200 to replace nowadays. A rental car key for a Ford Mustang. Will the owner please form a line outside? A camera, a black and green Eno case of mini light-emitting diodes, a Nexus tablet, a navy blue V-neck sweater, and a yellow jacket. So if you've lost any of those things, hard lines, no, seriously, if you've lost any of those things, just go upstairs to, I think it's either the office or the green room, but up in the upper floor of the convention center, where open spaces have been held and the Raspberry Pi lab is, and reclaim your property from there.
And you don't have to dance today like yesterday. So, our next speaker is Mike Pionat. A Python-powered hack day. Are you ready?
I am.
Give him a big hand.
Go, Mike.
Good morning, everybody.
Mike.
All right. My name is Mike, and one of the favorite things about my job is that I run our annual Hack Day event, which is actually next Thursday and Friday, so I'm going to be working on that as soon as I get done with this. So our Hack Day is basically a 24-hour period where people can take their crazy bright ideas from just being that little glimmer of a concept all the way to a prototype. They work in teams or alone, and then they've got a limited amount of time, even shorter than we have up here today, to stand up in front of our company and present them. So there are a panel of judges as well as a popular vote to decide who's got the most exciting projects in a variety of different categories. And folks win fabulous prizes and glory and honor. And this past couple of years, we've switched to having charitable donations. So each team is actually now playing for some charity they care about. So they might be helping women's health or helping build schools in Africa or protecting our digital freedoms with EFF. Well, okay. Well, anyway, that's a really great story, but where's the Python? So when I was first running this event, I put together a WordPress blog because it was easy, and it had pages that I could set up and user registration, and I could have a plugin that would email users, and I could have it automatically tweet for us, and I could have it manage our teams. Oh, wait. How is it going to manage my teams? Well, the easiest thing I was able to come up with was a stupid email form. So I did a lot of cut, copy, and paste, which made me a very sad panda because I had to manage all that through like a Google Docs spreadsheet. I wanted to shoot myself. So, what did we do? Like any self-respecting Pythonistas, we burned that thing to the ground, and we replaced it with Django. So, we do all the stuff that we did before, including self-service team management, voting by either website, text, or email, and this year we've added LDAP integration. Now, why do you care? Well, it's open source, so if you have a Hack Day event at your company, you can go get the source and customize it to how you need and have that help manage your event so you can deal with people's t-shirt sizes and dietary needs and memorializing your projects and all of that good stuff. And I'm really, really pleased to say that it was successfully used by at least one other company this past year, so yay. So if you want to go get that, head on out to GitHub. The URL's up there, mpurenot/hackday. If you want to get a hold of me, you can email me or hit me up on Twitter. And just because I was having fun yesterday, here's a special bonus link. So go out there and enjoy that as well. And I will yield back the balance of my time. Thank you. Thanks, have a great PyCon.
Mike Pernat. Thank you, Mike.
Hackday.